calling. Amen. Do not pass. Can you bow? Come on, let's give the Lord another hand of praise for being in his presence one more time. Are you ready for the word of God? Amen. Amen. Turn with me to the book of Hebrews as we look at our scripture today. The book of Hebrews. We're going to look at chapter 6 today. Amen. The end of chapter 6. The first three verses. Let us all stand for the reading of God's word. Hebrews chapter 6. We're going to look at the first three verses. It's going to be right there on the screen for you if you don't have your Bibles. And it's coming from the New King James Version, and it reads as follows. Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. Verse 2, of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, of the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. Verse 3, and this we will do if God permits. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to use your subject just for a few minutes. From inception to perfection. From inception to perfection. Let us bow our heads for a word. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you. Lord, we thank you once again for this opportunity to preach your gospel. Thank you for allowing us to hear it. Open up our spiritual understanding today as we begin, Father, to let your word move down deep down into our hearts. Lord, we allow your word to make a mark upon us that will never, ever be erased. And Lord, if there's somebody here today who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, Lord, it is our prayer that they say, what must I do to be saved? In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. From inception perfection. As you know, last Sunday, as we were finishing up chapter 5, which was chapter 5, verse 10 through 11, we started a series there. The series is called Moving Toward or Pressing Toward Maturity. And we did part one in the sermon last week, and from part one of this series was, it's time to grow up. Amen. Right. Amen. Amen. So now we move to part two of this sermon, from inception to perfection. And we need to understand that from inception to perfection means that God wants us to grow in his grace. Amen? Amen. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. So as I go through these points quickly, I'm not going to be before you long, but I'm going through several points showing you that we need to move from inception or from the beginning to perfection. Amen? Right. Now look at point number one. We need, right? We need to move on from the symbols about Christ. We need to move on from the symbols about Christ. And that's found in chapter 6, verse 1a. Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ. Now, leaving does not mean to get rid of here. It means to move on to the next level. How many of you want to go to the next level with God? Amen. It means to put up the symbols or the picture books and move on to the growing in Christ Jesus. It means, listen to this, it means that we need to put Jesus first and in maturity grow in Christ. So it does not mean get rid of the elementary of Jesus Christ. It means we need to grow in Christ. Right. So what are we supposed to leave? What are we supposed to move on from? The scripture says move on from the elementary teachings, literally the beginning teachings of Christ. There was a theologian by the name of John Calvin who said, as in building a house, one must never leave the foundation, yet to be always laboring in laying the foundation would be ridiculous. In other words, if you can't come to church Sunday after Sunday and say you get saved all over again. Amen. That's trying, that's on the foundation one time. Oh yeah, you build on the foundation. You grow with the foundation. Watch this. In other words, leaving means to get saved, yes, and move on, get saved and grow. When it says leave the elementary things of Christ is those people who have never accepted Jesus as their Savior. They're stuck in the elementary things of the world. They're stuck back in their own sins, and they refuse, watch this, to accept Christ and move on. So just adding Jesus to your lifestyle is not salvation. And we must turn away from a sinful lifestyle in order to pursue God. You know, some people say that these verses refer to Christians who need to grow up. But watch this, I really want you to be careful and listen to this. But we know that this passage is referring to unsaved people, because watch this, Christians is never seen in the Bible as, watch this, from the basic things of Christianity. Amen. You can't get saved just 100 times and then say, well, I think I need to get saved over again. It's almost sound like some of the doctrines of the Pentecostal movement. They believe if you commit one sin, you got to get saved all over again. Jesus was crucified only once. He wasn't crucified 1,000 times. He wasn't crucified 100 times. He was only crucified once for your sins and my sins. So guess what? You can't lay down the same foundation over again. It's time to move from your beginning to your perfection. It's time for you to move from your inception to perfection. Here's what Paul said. Remember his words. Paul said this in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14. But may it never be that I would boast except in the cross of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
All right.
Bring down to point number two. You need to look at the screen. Focus on Jesus and his perfection. So did you know that the word maturity means perfection? So when you become mature, you're not being perfected in yourself. You're being perfected through Jesus Christ. When you begin to grow in Christ, you're growing in maturity of what Jesus has done for you. Amen. Oh, yes, yes, look, watch this. Verse 1 says this: let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works. So maturity in Christ means perfection in Christ, which means you have to have salvation in Christ. In order to be perfect, you must be in the will of God. You must be in the perfection of Jesus Christ. Not perfect in ourselves, amen?
Amen.
The only way we can walk in perfection is if we walk it through Jesus Christ, amen?
Amen.
Only Christ's sacrifice is perfect. My sacrifice is not perfect. Your sacrifice is not perfect. Only Christ's sacrifice is perfect. How do I know? Hebrews 10:12 says this, but he, talking about Jesus, having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God. Oh yeah, the writer is talking about being saved by coming to Christ, because Jesus is our ultimate sacrifice. Amen. You see, perfection is described as something that is done to us, not something that we do. We need to get beyond believing that we can save ourselves. We need to get beyond the fact that we can kind of get ourselves into heaven. The only way you make it into the kingdom of God is through Christ. So guess what? The series is called Pressing On to Perfection, Pressing On to Maturity, which translates this: get saved, accept Jesus as your Savior, and then move on. See, sometimes people say they get saved and they stay right there. In order for me to know that you're growing in Christ, you got to grow in his word. Amen. You got to grow in his spirit. Look at point number three as I go on. This is point three. Receive the person of Christ through repentance. Now watch this. Move on from the symbol of repentance. That's growing in Christ. So what did verse 1b say? It says this: let us go on to perfection, laying laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works. So what is repentance in the Old Testament? Now watch this. You need to learn this lesson and learn it now. And this is the lesson that's going to help you throughout the rest of your Christian life. There is a maturity that you need to grow in. So this is how you know you're growing in maturity. You need to see the Old Testament as a picture book. And you need to see the New Testament as the reality. You need to see the Old Testament as, watch this, being in kindergarten and first grade. And you need to see the New Testament as being in college. Amen. You need to see the Old Testament, watch this, as symbols of our Christ. But the New Testament shows you what the symbols really mean. So in other words, you need to understand what things really symbolize in the Old Testament first, but you really need to know that the Old Testament always pointed to the New. Let me say that again. The Old Testament, no matter what teaching you're talking about, it always reflected toward Jesus Christ. So here's an example. Repentance. The Old Testament. The Old Testament form of repentance is this. If you don't turn from your evil ways, God gonna kill you. That's the Old Testament right there. You don't believe me? If you were a homosexual, you were killed. Guess what? If you were a liar, if you were disobedient to your parents, you can die. God didn't play with sin in the Old Testament. He don't play with sin in the New Testament. But guess what? In the Old Testament, you lost your life quicker in the Old Testament than you would in the New. So how does God deal with repentance in the New? Watch this. In the New Testament, God shows his repentance that you can get repentance by faith through Jesus Christ. Here it is, Acts 2:38. You remember, Peter said this to them. Repent, and each of you and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. That's the real repentance. The Old Testament showed you one way, but the New Testament gave you the reality. What is the reality? John told us the reality. John 14:6, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. That's the reality. If you don't put your faith in Jesus, if you don't repent to him, guess what? You are not saved. These are the elementary things that you need to move forward. You need to hold on to them, but need to move forward growing in Christ. He said this in verse 1b. He says, listen, repent from, watch this, dead works. What is dead works? Dead works is this. Any work that you try to do to get yourself into heaven outside of Jesus Christ is a dead work. Amen. So, well, what is the dead work? Let's say some people say, if I give enough money to the church, I'll make it to heaven. That's a dead work. Somebody said, if I help people give a few groceries, maybe God will be lenient on me and let me get into heaven. No, that's a dead work. There's nothing that you can do to get yourself into heaven. Every work that you try to think that you make it all right with God to get yourself into heaven, it's called, as he said here, a dead work. There's only one work that will get you into heaven, and that's the work of Jesus Christ. Somebody need to shout, amen. That's the only thing. Only one work, only Christ can cleanse us from these dead works. We call it, another word for it is works righteousness. You heard that phrase? There is no work. There is nothing absolutely that you can do to get yourself into heaven but believe that Jesus Christ is your Redeemer. Watch this, go to point number four right there on the screen. Not only that, we need to trust the purity that's in Christ. Watch this. Moving on from baptisms. Because see, verse 2 talked about, he started naming some things we need to move from. He says we need to move from dead works. That was one. And then he says we need to move from baptism. You said, wait a minute. Why should we move from baptism? Remember, let's see how the Old Testament looked at baptism and at the New Testament. In the Old Testament, when a Jew walked into his house, he had a basin sit right there the door, and he had to cleanse himself every single day. This was a ritual. They called it a baptism. to wash themselves. Not only did they have to do that, the priest also had to wash himself in every time he made a sacrifice. We thank God that we don't have to do that today, amen. The only baptism you need is the baptism that Jesus has. Listen to this. Titus 3:5 tells you his baptism. He saved us, not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit. The washing that you have, the washing that you need, is the washing of the Word of God. Amen. The washing of the Holy Spirit, cleaning your life up each and every day. See, what we're telling you is this: stop getting caught up into rituals and look at the reality of what those symbols are trying to tell you in the Old Testament. You got too many folks stuck back in Genesis to Malachi, and you want to do everything in Genesis and Malachi, but we want to pick and choose what we want to obey in Genesis from Malachi. You don't know what I'm talking about. Yeah. Okay, Leviticus chapter 11. Everybody want to do Leviticus chapter 11? In Leviticus chapter 11, there is a diet. In Leviticus chapter 11, don't eat this. Don't eat that. Don't eat anything crawling on the bottom of the sea. So religious people would say, see, the Bible says you can't eat shrimp. You can't eat catfish. You can't eat all of these things because they crawl at the bottom of the sea. Well, that's if you stuck in the Old Testament.
Amen.
See, what he's trying to tell you is we got to cleanse ourselves from the symbols, and we need to look at the reality. I'm going to take you back once again so you can understand what the Old Testament is. I told you the Old Testament is like being in first grade. The Old Testament is like being in the kindergarten. It's like being in second grade. It's like being in third grade. Watch this. In those grades, you're learning how to read. In this first grade, guess what? They show you a picture book. In other words, before you learn how to read, they show you symbols. Okay, here's a picture of a ball. See the ball? Then you connect the word ball with the picture. Then when you get to the second grade, see Jack run.
You can knock them shoes. We gonna buy
clothes. Watch this. Some casual clothes. See, this wasn't me. I'm telling you, it was a hard to get me into a shirt like this. It was hard to get some jeans. I had a shirt and tie on. I was 16 years old. Now, that's because I had in my mind that somehow I'm pleasing God. But once I got the truth, in the Word of God, Lord, God don't care about this. He cares about the inside instead of the outside. Let me tell you what he told the Pharisees. You remember, he told the Pharisees this one day when they thought the inside was better than the outside was better than the inside. He said this. He said, let me tell you about your washing. He said, you know how to wash the outside of a cup real good. But you need the inside of the cup real dirty.
Yeah.
It's filthy. Watch this. Bring me to point number five. He says this. Accept the substitution of Christ. Move on from the symbol of laying on of hands. So in the Old Testament, listen, the laying on of hands was this. The priest, he would go in the Old Testament, he was laying his hands on the animal. Sacrifice. And then he will put his hands and lay hands. And what he was doing was, he was transferring, watch this, symbolically, the sins of the people to the animal before he sacrificed them. So now let's move, that's the picture book, that's the picture. I'm laying on, they did this every day, they did it every year. That is a symbol, it's a picture, it is a symbol of what? And one day, Jesus will come. Not watch this, and he will put on him all of your sins, and he will accept all of your problems, and Jesus will never, he will never walk away from you, but he will wash every sin away from you, amen? Oh, yeah, 2 Corinthians, you don't believe me, 2 Corinthians 5 says this. He, talking about God, made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Transferred all of your sins, everything you thought that was wrong, every deed that you did wrong in your body, they were all transferred from you to Jesus. Remember, Jesus lived 2019 years ago. Yep, that means Jesus took on everybody's sin, was born, right, and whoever will be born. He took on all of your sins on himself on the cross. He transferred it to him. He became sin on the cross for you. It wasn't his sin. It was your sin. You know that lie you told? It was on the cross. On Jesus. Remember all the times you did wrong? Everything you did wrong. Think about it. I don't know. I wasn't there. I know what I did. But I thank God he took them all. I thank God he took them all. Some of you know me. Dead sleeping in your brain right now. If you want the God who saved you out of that sin and out of that shame that you were in, you will not be here today. You need to give God some praise. Tell him, thank you, Lord, for what you've done for me. Point number six. Not only that, you got to rely on the power of Christ. You got to rely on his resurrection of the dead. Rely on the power of Christ, resurrection of the dead. Move from the symbol in the Old Testament of the resurrection of the dead. You know they talked about resurrection of the dead, even in the Old Testament. I'll give you one. Job said this. As for me, Job 19, I know that my Redeemer lives. And watch this. This is what he said about the resurrection. And at the last, he will take his stand on the earth. 26. Even after my skin is destroyed, from my flesh, I shall see God. So even in the Old Testament, talk about the resurrection, but let's bring it down to the new. That's the real, that's the picture book. Let's look at the real resurrection. Matthew said this when he talked about the resurrection, because he knew that the Pharisees believed in the resurrection, but they didn't believe in the resurrection of Jesus. So Matthew, Jesus said this to them. Woe to you scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You are like whitewashed tombs, which are on the outside appear beautiful, but inside they are full of dead men, bones, and all unclean. How is it that you believe in the resurrection of the dead, but you don't believe when I tell you that I'm going to rise on the third day?
Amen.
He says, how is it that you don't believe in my resurrection? You keep saying there will be a resurrection. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, right? I am the one that's going to raise people up from the dead. So I tell you today, do you believe in the resurrection? Do you believe in the real reality of it? And the reality is this. He got up for your victory. Yes, he did. He rose on the third day. So if you have all power in heaven and earth in his hands for you and for me. Oh, yeah. Resurrection is only through Jesus Christ. Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Watch this. Point seven. He said this. Acknowledge. Watch this. Point seven. Acknowledge that the judge is Christ. So this is the last one we got to move on to. He says, move on from the symbol of eternal judgment in the old and move on to the reality of what judgment is. In the Old Testament, it taught that God judges man. In the book of Ecclesiastes, it says this. Chapter 12, verse 14. But God will bring every act to judgment, right? Everything which is hidden, whether it is good or evil, God is going to what? He's going to expose it. But watch this. Jesus said this in the New Testament, John 5, 22, for not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment unto me. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
So if he says in the Old Testament, here's the picture, judgment. Jesus is the judge, and you